ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Exotic Astrology. And after a long time, I will make another funny video on 10 top misconceptions in the astrological community and what are they and how they try to prove that they are actually not misconceptions, but what they are saying is actually true. I will also say about that. All right, so enjoy the rest of this video, okay? And yes, if you are new to the channel and if you have not yet subscribed, then you can subscribe down somewhere below. And if you want a consultation from me, or if you have also questions regarding such funny interpretations, then you can please go to my website to book a reading. You will find the link down, okay? And yes, if you like this video, click the thumbs up and please share it with people who are not aware of these misconceptions, all right? And before I begin, as I always say, God is there with you all the time. Just look to Him and you will find Him. Okay, so I have the list here. I will start. Okay, so the first misconception people have is Jupiter's exaltation sign is in Cancer. Why? So there, recently I was watching a channel. It's a Hindi astrology channel. No offense to Hindi or Indian, so anybody. But he was telling there that, should I say in Hindi or English? So Jupiter gets exalted in Cancer. Guru Kark Rashi mein uch ke hote hai. The reason, and the funny reason which he gave was because Cancer is the fourth house of the mother, you know. So he said, Mata jo hoti hai, bacche ki param guru hoti hai, pehli guru hoti hai wo. So this means that he said that the mother is the first guru of the child, you know. That is why Jupiter, which is the planet of guru, of knowledge, wisdom, teaching, gets exalted in the sign or the house of the mother. That he did not say, but he said ma ke ghar mein, which means in the house of the mother. But Jupiter, see, Cancer is the fourth house. Yes, it's the fourth sign actually, rather than the fourth house. And Jupiter, no planet gets exalted in a house. It gets exalted in a sign. Because sign represents those internal traits which you feel. Okay. And house represents the external traits. And we all know where Jupiter gets directional strength. It is in the Lagna. So Jupiter does not get exalted in the fourth house. It gets exalted in Cancer. And it does not get directional strength in the fourth house. It gets directional strength in the Lagna. Okay. Now, why Jupiter gets exalted in Cancer? There are many reasons. But the prime reason is because Lord Krishna, because Jupiter is what? Our spiritual progress ultimately. How much spiritual progress we have made, right? So, when Jupiter is in Cancer, it means that our spiritual level has, spiritual elevation has reached to such an extent that we are able to connect to God at an emotional level. And this I'm not saying from my side, this Lord Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita. He says at the end, you know, bhakti maim param kritva, that only by using bhakti yoga, through bhakti yoga, you can approach me very fast. And bhakti yoga is what, basically, when you say that Hanuman is a bhakt of Lord Ram, it means that he is a great devotee. He has emotions for Lord Ram. He can do anything, just like a man and a woman who love each other, they will do anything. Yes, so Lord Ram, for his satisfaction, Hanuman will, you know, go and burn the Lanka. He will go and get the Sanjeevani booty, yes, from Dronagiri Parvat, and he brings the mountain itself, okay. So, a bhakta is one who is ready to do anything to make God happy. Yes, just like a man and a woman may be sometimes ready to do anything to make their partner happy. So, that's like the highest level of spirituality. On the other hand is Capricorn, where you are just officially, it's like a barren sign where you are just officially doing, you know, Shri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram, Shri Ram, Jai Ram, Jai Jai Ram. Hanumanji will not chant like this. He will chant with feelings, he will chant with love, he will chant with emotions, he will chant with... Oh. That is why when he ripped apart his chest, you know, somebody asked him that, where is Lord Ram? Where is Sita? He said, you want to see them? Ah. You can see that. Okay. So, unless we emotionally involve ourselves in our spiritual practices, it will not sink down, deep down in our heart. Okay. That's the reason Jupiter gets exalted. And as I said, Krishna also says that in the Gita. Now, the second misconception is Navamsha gets active after marriage, or Navamsha gets active after 25, or it gets active after 35, it gets active after 45. Okay. But the question is, what if you don't marry? Then Navamsha doesn't get active, right? But what if you die at the age of 25? Yes, there are many people who die. So for them, what happens? Navamsha doesn't get active, right? No. There's a confusion. No, there's no confusion. Vishti Larson has made it clear. Okay. Navamsha does not get active after only after marriage. In fact, Navamsha decides the situation during your birth. Okay. So if you want to know more about that, then you can type Navamsha, N-A-V-A-M-S-H-A in my channel. The first video which you see in that playlist out of top 10. And till now, I have uploaded 6 or 7 videos of that playlist. And the rest I will upload maybe till you see this video. So the first video, there you will see where Vishti Larson explains in detail when Navamsha gets active and how to see that. Okay, he speaks very elaborately on that. Okay, and individually it will depend on your charts. Okay, so it is not that it gets active after marriage, or because nowadays the definition of marriage has also changed. You know, nowadays there are live-in relationships, people are doing so many things, and there are marriages within the same sex also. So it's not that it gets active after marriage or anything like that. Okay, that's a very big misconception. I don't know from where all this rubbish has come, but it's there all over in YouTube, and I'm flooded with questions. Oh, my Navamsha is active, maybe, you know, I'm 40, so now my Navamsha is active, my Rashi chart has gone into the dustbin. No, it doesn't happen like this. It never happens, and Navamsha is active from the moment you are born. In fact, before that. Okay, so don't have this misconception that Navamsha gets active after marriage or after 35, okay? Or they also say it gets active in the later part of life. Now, how do you define later part? For somebody who lives for 40 years, for him later part is after 20s. For somebody who lives for 80 years, for him later part is, you know, after 40. So, you cannot define what later half is. You can just assume that, oh, maybe this is his later half, but he may die tomorrow. That happens all the time, okay? Then the next big thing is Venus gets exalted another in the 12th house of the natural in the 12th house. Okay, again, exalted not in 12th sign, in the 12th house. Okay, and what does this mean? This means that anybody who has an exalted Venus, they will have a great, you know, intimate, romantic, passionate sex life, because 12th house is that, and Venus is the planet of sexuality, right? Well, Venus does not get exalted in the 12th house. Again, it gets Digbala in the 4th house. Okay. And Venus gets exalted in the original 12th sign, which is the sign of Pisces, which is where you serve others. You serve those people who you love. Yes. That is why when you love somebody, you always want to make that person happy. Yes. So that's the reason Venus gets exalted there, because Pisces is the sign where you want to give, where you don't want to take. And on the other hand, where Venus gets debilitated is in Virgo, when you are only thinking of yourself. No, you did not fulfill my expectations. You didn't do this. You didn't do that. So I will not stay with you. What a great thing I am doing, right? Staying with you. What a great honor you have to have me in your life. Yes, there are people who make such statements. I have seen couples. So their relationship is completely ruined because of that. Now, the next misconception, funny misconception is, Sade Sati will ruin my life. Yes, this is big again. Sade Sati is when Saturn transits in the 12th house from a moon, over the moon and in the second house. So suppose your moon is in Aquarius. Okay. So the 12th house is Capricorn. Then the moon sign is Aquarius, then Pisces. So that means January next year, or February, I guess, whenever Saturn enters Capricorn next year, 2020, then the Sade Sati for the people who have moon in Aquarius will start. Okay, that's the first phase. Then second phase is when Saturn is directly over your moon. Then third phase is when Saturn is the second house. Now, what Sade Sati is and all that, we will discuss in some other video. But when these funny misconceptions are there that it will ruin your life, no, it cannot ruin your life, because that's simply another transit. Yes. There are people like Narendra Modi and Indira Gandhi, both from the BJP and Congress, there are examples. that when Sade Sati happened, they became the Prime Minister of India, okay? Sade Sati will only speak in the tone of your Dasha. Yes, 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 yes. Whatever Dasha says ultimately happens. Vimshottari Dasha is there. Uru Dasha is there. Chala Dasha is there. Narayan Dasha is there. So many Dasha systems are there. So, Dasha is what is your destiny, okay? Transit is to whatever extent you are feeling that during that time, okay? So, for example, suppose your Dasha is telling you, you are going to have a great success in your career. And suppose during that time, the transits are happening that in a way that there are too many planets in your sixth house. Then it can happen that when that success is coming, you can encounter too much competition. But at the end, the success will happen because the Dasha is promising that, okay? Transits can never override the Dasha. Remember, that's the first rule. That these are basics of astrology. So, Sade Sati or any kind of transit of Saturn, Rahu, Ketu, Mars, Sun, Moon, whatever it is, they can never ruin you unless the Dasha is like that, okay? And if Dasha has decided that you will be ruined, whichever house, whichever planets transit, you will face challenges, okay? And about Sade Sati, we will discuss more in future. Now this one, next one is big. Remedies will change your karma. So, basically, there was one person who asked me, that person had booked a soulmate reading from me where I gave a probable time period for when you could find somebody with whom you can get into a relationship or marriage or something like this. So that person asked me, so when is the time when I am meeting my soulmate? And question number two, please give me some remedies, okay? So then I saw his chart and then I saw there is unfortunately not much, you know, in the chart which is indicating that he might be maybe into a relationship. But then when I replied to the person that these are some periods are there, but there are still these are also a bit challenging. Then that person said, give me a remedy by which I can force my soulmate. We cannot do that. You cannot force things. Remedies will work in the jurisdiction of your karma, okay? Because the fact that you get a remedy or not is also dependent on your karma. There are many things to see, you know, the ninth lord, Jupiter's placement, planets in the ninth house, they will tell you what is the strength of remedies, what's the extent to which remedies will work. Wherever the ninth lord is, the ninth lord in a fixed sign, is the ninth lord in a movable sign, or is it in a dual sign, what is its placement in the navamsha, it will depend on so many other things, okay? So I have a video on money remedy in my channel which has got over 30-31,000 views. So there one person commented that, and that's a very genuine comment, I would say. So I would like to take up that comment. One person has commented there that, oh, if this remedy would have worked, then everybody would have become Bill Gates, right? So this inherently means that that person has assumed that things which are not there in my karma will happen. Now suppose if an ordinary person, like maybe you watching this video or me, we do the remedy, we may get some 100 rupees, 1000 rupees, some 10,000 or maybe 1 lakh, 2 lakh rupees, whatever is there in our karma. But suppose Bill Gates does this remedy, he may get money in billions. Of course, he will not do such remedies, but I'm just giving an example. He may earn money in billions because that's what his destiny is, right? Whenever he will earn a lot of money. So don't worry if, and there are many people who have also told me that that remedy doesn't work. You know, there are 20-30% of the people who have commented that it's a fake remedy, doesn't work. But then 70-80% say it works. Now, how it can happen that for some it is working, for some it is not working, okay? So if the money is not there in that Dasha period, if the Dasha period is signifying that you will have loss of money, that remedy will not work, okay? That's the statement which I am giving. That money remedy is useless for you. It will not work. It can work at some other time, of course, when a good Dasha comes. And this is the same for mantras and for all this, okay? So when you chant mantras, it doesn't mean that if you are destined to follow celibacy, out of the sky a man or a woman will pop and they will start enjoying with you. It doesn't mean that. It means that there is some inner capacity in you which you think that another person can fulfill, okay, which you can yourself fulfill. So that lesson you will learn from the mantras, that how can I stay happy without that person, how can I learn the lesson that maybe I did something to somebody because of which now I am suffering. So next time you will not do like this with anybody. So that mantras ensure that you learn the lesson. It doesn't, you know, give you $1 billion. Okay, there is no mantra for that. Okay. Then the next, transits are more important than dashas. This is what I already told you. This is another very big misconception. You know, it doesn't work like that. Transits, they say, are like the delivery boy. So the delivery boy walks in every room of the house, but he has a list of what to give you. Okay, so suppose the dasha is saying that you will have great things in life, in one area of life, for example marriage or something like this, then it can happen that when some transit is coming, then if it's a difficult transit, then using some challenges and difficulties, you will finally get it. Finally, that will happen. But it can, it does not mean that because the transits are happening in a difficult house, for example, 8th house, for example, it doesn't mean that you will have defamy or something like this, okay? Unless the dasha is indicating, it will not happen. So when we watch videos like, oh, Jupiter transit into Scorpio, yes, I also made that video. So that has around 37,000 views. So people are asking that, oh, nothing of that sort has happened. You know, Jupiter has transited to my 11th house. Like for Capricorn, Jupiter is in the 11th house now. So does that mean that all the Capricorn ascendants in this world, and there are 7 billion people approx. So if you divide, like if you take 6 billion and you divide it into 12 ascendants, so you get, you know, 0.5. So that many number of people, do you think that they will all have the same results? No, dasha is individual to you. The dasha which you are running, nobody else in the entire universe can run it. Okay, because you may be in Jupiter Mahadasha like hundreds of other people, but you will have a different antardasha. But you may have the same antardasha, but a different pratyantar, but a different portion of it will be remaining. Okay, or if the portion is also same, your moon will be in a different nakshatra, your lagna will be different, your lordship of Jupiter is different, everything is different. There are no two same individuals in this world, so there are no two same horoscopes. Okay, all right. So the next misconception is Venus or seventh lord in sixth indicates divorce. Okay, no, it doesn't. Barack Obama has Venus in the sixth house and he has not had a divorce. Okay, now there are people who also have seventh lord in the sixth. It doesn't indicate a divorce, but it is one of the indicators to a difficult marriage. Okay, so when you say to somebody that you will have a divorce, it means you are giving a prediction independent of the dasha. So unless the dasha is signifying divorce very strongly, and divorce is generally happening when the first house, sixth house, eighth house and the 12th house are connected, generally then the divorce happens. Okay, and the dasha has to be of a natural malefic like Saturn, Rahu, Ketu or Sun or Mars, and so many other things are there. These are some combinations which I am telling you, but just like the other day somebody told me that, oh, my Venus is in sixth, you know, so I will have a divorce or I will always have breakups. No, so suppose you have a planet in sixth house, suppose let's take the example, suppose you have moon in the seventh house, you have Mars in the sixth house and you have Rahu in the 11th house. Okay, so the houses 2, 7 and 11, they give you great marriage. Okay, good married life. And the houses 1, 6, 8 and 10 and 12, they don't give you that great of a marriage. So now moon is in the 7th house, so married life during those 10 years will be good. And then Mars dasha comes after moon. I'm talking of Vimshottari here. Okay, standard. Then Mars is 7 years, so that time you can have difficulties in your married life. That will happen because the sixth house is known for difficulties in marriage. Then after Mars, Rahu comes for 18 years, which is in your 11th house. So then good things in marriage will come. Okay, and so like that you judge a married life, because when you say he married life, it is not an event like wedding. Wedding is different from marriage. Wedding is the event when you get married, but married life is like you are judging 30 years. And no dasha planet is 30 years long. Venus is 20 years long. But marriages go more than 20 years sometimes. Okay, most of the times in India at least. Exaltation is great, debilitation is horrible. Okay, so I made a video on exaltation and debilitation. Please type in my channel exaltation, or you can type debilitation. So you will find I made that video. So where I've said exaltation means the awareness is high, debilitation means the awareness is low. Okay, so you will find countless people who in their exalted planets dasha have suffered miserably. Okay, and in fact below that video somebody has commented also, I've seen that my Jupiter is exalted and the dasha was miserable. So if the dasha is miserable, it means that exalted Jupiter is connected to the Dusthana houses. Only then it will happen. Okay, it is in the nakshatra of a Dusthana lord, or it is itself in a Dusthana. Okay, then that's a problem. But Jupiter exaltation will give you very high awareness in spirituality. Okay, and awareness of the karakatvas of Jupiter. So I will not speak much about this here. You can watch that video. Okay, exaltation and debilitation. I have made that video. It's there in this playlist itself. OMG Astrology Secrets. Then, no free will. You don't have free will. Okay, so some astrologers say everything is predestined. You can't do anything. It's all nonsense, rubbish. Just stop it. Finished. Yes, you can't do anything. It's over. Well, whatever happens to you is destined. They are right, but you always have the free will to react on it. So suppose somebody comes and speaks badly to us. So that is our destiny. We cannot stop it. Okay. But what do? We also talk back in the same tone, or we talk politely. That is our free will. Okay. Now somebody will comment on the chart here below in the comments that, oh, there's a person who insults me every time, you know. Well, then that's a different issue. But in general, I am talking in a layman's term. Okay, so the free will is always there. Nobody can take your free will away from you. Okay. But whatever is destined to happen to you, that also you cannot stop. Okay, so these two things go simultaneously. So free will and destiny are not at war. Okay. Both are different things. Destiny is what happens and free will is how you react. I am repeating again. Okay. This is the last funny thing which people say. Saturn gets exalted in Libra. Why? Because Libra is the sign of other people and Saturn likes teamwork. I mean, come on. Saturn is the last planet which likes teamwork. He likes to do things alone. And that is what represents. That is why Saturn gets exalted there. Because when you are in Libra, you are forced to stay away from the traits of Libra. Okay. Away in the sense that wherever Saturn is sitting, he will try to throw you away from that house. So when you are away from Libra, what is there? Aries is there. So that means when you are in Aries, you are forced to do things alone. And that is where you master. And this I am not saying this. Ernst Wilhelm has said, okay. Ernst Wilhelm, as you know, is one of the greatest astrologers. He recently came to my channel and I'm going to upload his videos also. So that's what he has said there. Okay. And Saturn gets Digbala in the 7th house. Apart from getting exalted in the original 7th sign. Not house, 7th sign. So Saturn also gets Digbala, directional strength in the 7th house. Because Lord Krishna also says in the Gita, Antakalecha mameva smaran muktva kalevaram hetu nanenda konteya. So this means what? That antakalecha mameva, whatever desire you have at the time of your death, which is the house of desires, the 7th house. At the time of your death, 7th house is the house where the sun sets. That will decide your next birth. So to the extent you will suffer in a human, in a man's body, in a woman's body, in a cat's body, in a pig's body, in a dog's body, in a elephant's body, in your next life, the extent of suffering is dependent on what you are desiring. And Lord Krishna also says, yes, that one who thinks about me when he dies, he goes back to my abode and he does not return back. Yad gatva nani vartante tad dhama parama mama. So the kind of desires that you have, which is 7th house, will decide your suffering. So the worse are the better the desires, you will have a better future, because then your next life will be good. And if you are thinking of God, then you will go back to the spiritual world. You will not return back. And if you are thinking of materialistic attachments, then Saturn is going to hit you there. And that's the place where he can hit you the hardest. And Saturn is also the judge. So he can actually punish you there. Okay. So if you are thinking of sex or your wife or your husband, then you will take birth in a body where you can keep having sex all the time. Yes. Like the birth in the, I don't know, some animals maybe. Not all the time doesn't mean 24 hours, but there are many animals, there are many birds who have a very, you know, active sex life. Okay, so these are the things which I wanted to say. These are the funny misconceptions which people have put all over regarding astrology. Okay, so please share this video with somebody who you think is also a victim of these misconceptions. Okay, until next time, wish you good luck. And yes, God is there with you all the time. Just look to him and you will find him. And if you want a reading, please go down to my website below. Okay, until next time, bye bye, see you.